thank you for the music and your stories of the road. I thank you for the freedom when it came my time to go. I thank you for the kindness and the times when you got tough. And Papa, I don't think I said I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old, but his blood runs through my instrument and his song is in my soul. My life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. I am a living legacy to the leader of the band.
Lots of people know of the Concordia Christmas Concert and make it a part of their holiday outings every year. But in a more rural community in the Red River Valley, a Christmas cantata has been performing since 1995. The director, Kent Loken, has been sharing his talent and passion with the community for many years.
My name is Kent Loken, and I'm the director of the Community Christmas Choir and Orchestra Cantata. And it's been a pleasure to have been involved with this since 1995. I was the music teacher at Campbell Tinta, which I did for 23 and a half years prior to going to Concordia. And so I had, my responsibility there was everything music, kindergarten through senior in high school. The last 13 years of my musical career, I was the administrator of all of the instrumental ensembles at Concordia College. So I was responsible for the band, the orchestra, the jazz band, the percussion ensemble, anything instrumental. It was my job to manage all of that. Well, humble beginnings starts in western North Dakota. I was actually born in the town of Hettinger. My dad was a Lutheran minister, and his first parish was Reeder. So over the first few years of my life was Reeder, North Dakota. I don't remember much about that, but then we moved to Beach. Dad got a calling to Beach. And my mom was a stay-at-home pastor's wife, raising her children. So Beach, North Dakota was my elementary years. I went through sixth grade there, so that's where I started my musical career, if you want to call it that. I took up the trumpet when I was in fifth grade. And my older brother, Mark, took up the baritone, euphonium, when he was in sixth grade, so we sort of were in band together. And of course, back then, before computers, you had to write everything out, and my dad, you had to transpose because the trumpet is not the same key as the piano. So a lot of time spent writing. So I thought there's got to be an easier way to do that. So I figured out in my head how to play in a different key than the piano was in by transposing. I said, Dad, you don't need to do that anymore. So kind of realized I might have had a more than just a passing interest in trumpet at that time. Got to Concordia College. I ended up going there because that's where my mom went. She got a degree in mathematics. My older brother went to Augustana, which was where my dad went, and I said, okay, I'm gonna go someplace. I wanna go where mom went. Ended up going up there, got into the band. My advisor ended up putting me into like the first year, what you would take if you're gonna be a music ed major. So harmony and ear training, and at that point, I really figured out that I had a passion for it because it's just I didn't really learn that stuff. I learned how to play my trumpet, but I didn't learn, you know, like key signatures, major scales, minor, all of that stuff. It was just, so when I got to Concordia as a declared math major, I immediately switched. By the end of my first semester, I was hooked. I said, I'm gonna be music.
Loken has been a music educator throughout his career from high school to college. I found that everyone I interviewed had so much to say about him, I challenged them to sum up their experiences with Kent into one word, an impossible ask.
My name is Peter Haberman, and I'm the director of bands at Concordia College. Started here in 2012, so I worked with Kent from 2012 until he retired, but he's quite the warm individual. Big heart. That really drives a lot of what motivates Kent. When he's committed to an idea, a person, a community, he's all in. Right, he's gonna do everything he can to help that situation.
My name is Matthew Winarski. Here at Concordia, I'm the instrumental ensembles manager, which means I work with the bands, the orchestras, the instrumental area, taking care of their logistics, concerts, tours, programs, all sorts of things like that. unpredictable, and I mean that in an excitement kind of way. Like, I'll just take, because this year was my first year actually getting to do the cantata. Schedule-wise, different things has come up to where I haven't before, but this year I was so glad I got to. And Kent's been a band director. He's worked here at Concordia. Like, he's been involved in music for just so long. And seeing him conduct, it's like we've made this just amazing, like, musical product and performance. And the whole time, like, he is just one with the music, which doesn't necessarily mean a pattern or something we can read, but it's like, I know my energy level and I know the excitement level and how I should be playing because of how he conducts. And it was just, it's so much excitement.
My name is Valerie Nelson, and I have been a member of the local Christmas Cantata Choir for probably 15 or 20 years. If I had to just use one word to describe Kent Loken, our director, I would say inspirational. He really is an inspiration to me. He is just, he gets the entire choir just so inspired to give this message every year. He is dedicated. He works so hard to get this production together. And I know it's not just something that starts in October, November, and then we perform it in December. I'm pretty sure he's busy working on this year round. Our Wahpeton Breckenridge area is really blessed to have Kent and his wife, Annette, as members of this community. Their willingness to share their gifts and their talents and to put on productions like the Christmas Cantata. We are just so lucky to have the Lokens in our community.
And like I said before, I've sung with just a number of groups over, you know, over in my tenure, I guess, if you want to call it that. Kent Loken brings this group together better than any director that I've ever sung for. We don't put this, a lot of people don't realize, we don't put the instrumentation with the singers until the day we're going to sing the concert. And so it would be a Saturday morning. Kent and Jana brought the orchestra in and set up, and when that orchestra, we were sitting up there, standing up there, ready to, when that orchestra started to play, it raised the hair on my arms. I said, this is something. And that's a tribute. He makes it fun, but he makes it meaningful at the same time. You want to sing. It's not work.
And it's really kind of neat when, after every practice, as we get better, you know, learn the numbers better, he seems moved by what he's hearing as well, and that just makes everything get better.
Because this cantata means so much to me, and Kent means so much to me, I drive from Battle Lake to all the practices to make sure that I'm there on time, and I study the music and learn it, and I hope to keep doing it for a while. It's real dear to my heart. But
his
blood
runs through my eyes. His co-director remembers how the cantata came to be in 1995 and how its effect on the community continues to grow.
I'm Jana Burnt, and I am one of the co-directors for the cantata that's been going on for 27 years. You know, the story of this goes back to 1995. We had a pastor at that time that was new to our congregation. We were at the Breckenridge United Methodist Church. And Pastor Terry Tilton had a cantata that they had done at their previous church. And so he grabbed, at that time I was playing piano, and Kent Loken was in the music area at our church. And he just pulled us aside one day and said, what do you guys think of this idea of maybe taking our choir and the piano and let's try a cantata? And many of us have never even heard of that word cantata. So it was a nice introduction. The first year was called Love Transcending. And if I were picking my style of music, I would tell you that wouldn't have been one I'd pulled off the shelf. But it was certainly a great introduction, and it's the start of a beautiful tradition for our church and for our community.
And then the next year, as we got close again in the fall, Jen and I talked about, well, should we do this again? We talked to Terry and said, well, sure. So we had more of an opportunity then, knowing more about what a cantata was or is, we looked at some other ones to pick one that we take more ownership in when you can choose the one that you want. Well, I could hold this up in the sanctuary, and this is exactly where we were, but this is a picture of what I would call the first orchestra. This young man right here, his name is Will Hibben. He's the grandson of one of our choir members, Don Hoagland. And he actually played violin in the Concordia Orchestra. And at that time, I was working at Concordia. So he came down and played the violin along with a couple of the songs in the cantata. And when it was over, I said, Will, why don't you bring a couple of your friends next year? You know, just saying, how about if we have like a quartet or something? So the year after that, and this is the first year when I would say we'd have a full orchestra, because we had one tuba, one baritone, a couple of trumpets, but one violin, one viola, one cello, one bass, one flute, one oboe, one piccolo, you know. So this orchestra actually fit in our sanctuary along with the choir, and you can see that the choir now has grown from more than 14 to, you know, maybe in the 20s and almost 30. So in this sanctuary, again, where we had our humble beginnings, we are now growing. We've grown the choir to a larger number of people that want to participate in the choir, to actually having an orchestra. Again, you talk about taking something from the humble beginnings and watching it grow. We could make the analogy to the humble beginnings of Jesus' birth, to his ministry and watching that grow. And I would have to say that that's a message that more so nowadays with the condition of that the world is in, that's a message that we need to hear even more deeply and say, how can we deal with all the chaos? How can we deal with all the turmoil that's going on in the world and in the whole world and still be at peace with who we are and what we do? And the message that we bring through this cantata is it's a message of hope. It's a message of, the title of this year's cantata is Look to Christ. It's a message of, you know, there you can find peace, there you can find hope, there you can find solace and say, okay, the world is a mess, but I'm okay. Well, we know that in our world there's a lot of distractions. Some of them are good. You know, this time of the year we're filled with joy, we're filled with, you know, you think of some of the Christmas songs that you hear on the radio. You know, Silver Bells, White Christmas, you get all those, their messages of happiness and joy. We're gonna lay our burdens and all the turmoil, we're gonna lay those at the feet of Jesus, we're gonna do that. And not only are we gonna do that, but we're gonna go tell others. It takes us through that. The birth, you know, all of that, this is what we, and now we're gonna go. And that's what, you know, that's how it ends. It's, for me, it's very personal. I mean, it has been from the get-go, but even more so now when we have more of a stake in creating it.
Now, I have sung around 12 times for Kent during the Christmas cantata, and I always wondered about one tradition that the choir does every week after their rehearsals and before they perform.
We start our practices with a song that is not sung in the cantata. It's called I Love You, Lord, and it brings us all into a place of holy ground. And Kent is the leader of that that sense of being doing more than just practicing the music.
And that was not deliberately. I'm looking for, it comes out of the faith we sing. It's called I Love You, Lord, and the words seem to fit. And we did this, this is several years ago. Jana actually brought it out and said, what can we do with this? So we use that at every rehearsal because the words I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you. Oh, my soul, rejoice. You know, take, and then you take those words and they become very meaningful to you. So at every rehearsal, we would end that as we were preparing to leave and go, but we would dim the lights or sometimes shut the lights off. And then that's sort of worked its way into, that's how we as a choir prepare ourselves to go out and present this to the people that have come to hear it. Just such an emotional way for us to do that final preparation is, okay, this is what we're doing. I lift my voice to worship you, and then, oh, my soul rejoice. So.
It's also not just about music. The Cantata partners every year with the local backpack program to provide meals for children who may not get enough to eat at home.
For years and years, we have felt that this is a gift. You notice that we don't charge an admission. There's not a ticket. You don't have to pay. But we do openly and without apology ask for a free will offering. And so a number of years ago, we said, what agency or what organization in town would be a great partner for us at Christmas time? And started talking to the Food Backpack Program. And that's a program where they help 11 schools, 350 kids every week, get a package of food that they bring home. And you know, you hear the stories from the kids and how much it means to them to have this food. Number one, the kids, it's kid friendly, so they can help cook it, but also it helps the family. But when you think of, you know, the last couple of years, 38,000 has gone back into the backpack program. Last year it was about $7,500, almost $8,000 that we gave to the backpack. That to me is the ultimate gift. Like, we're sharing with the community the story of Jesus through music and narration, and now they're responding and saying, you know what, Christmas, can you imagine being in a family where you don't have enough food? And we're talking about buying gifts, and we're talking about, you know, all the Christmas hoopla, and there's families that really are struggling even to put food on the table. So to think that we can respond to a community need with something that we so love to share with the community, it's just a great partnership, and we're so thrilled. You know, each year we say, is there another partner? I can't think of a better one than when you talk about the basics of food. I mean, can you imagine going to school and all you can think about is my stomach, my tummy is rumbling, I'm hungry. How can you learn, right? And we take it for granted. I don't know that my kids swear that they get hungry, but they don't really know hunger, I think, when you come from a family that maybe isn't able to have three meals a day or.
You know, 10, 15 years, where is this at?
Right?
Has this maybe outgrown this place?
I think for me, one of the questions that I continually ask is, unfortunately, my years aren't going backwards. I mean, I'm getting older every year, Kent's getting older every year. Like, what is this? What do we got to do to sustain this? Because it is so wonderful. But it's a unique partnership with Kent and I as we've been working all these years together. And so, yeah, I don't know where God will take this. I think God is doing some great work with this. And so, we'll, you know, time will tell. But right now, it's still something that we all need. It's something that the community really has responded well to, and yeah, wouldn't that be fun? Maybe we'll have to go to an extra show.
I was thinking about that, and you know, when we've been over to Science School, and you've been there, the stage is huge, and this year we're using more. We're taking advantage of the depth, but we're limited. And as word gets out, which it still is, because believe it or not, there are people in the community that still haven't heard about this. Well, why haven't I heard about this before? Well, it's not for lack of trying on our part to get the word out as many ways as we can. that still haven't been there. So we're anticipating, and we have people that travel down from the Fargo-Moorhead area. We have, our daughter lives in Brookings. My sister and her husband came from White Bear Lake. They are in it. And my other sister has been here. She comes from Tennessee. She wants to be here for it. So as people from surrounding communities, and there's a word that we should emphasize too, the word community, because we always call it the Community Choir and Orchestra Christmas Cantata. Because we're finding as we grow, most of the growth comes from within the groups, because they are inviting people. You should come. They're hearing somebody who has a nice voice. I said, you should come and sing in this. It's a commitment that goes from the beginning of October till now, second weekend in December. And it's an experience that when you're involved with it, it's something that really becomes very meaningful.
I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old.
It seems the faith, tradition, and message of this performance will continue to spread across not only this region, but perhaps the world. This is Madison Quinn reporting for the Mighty 790 and 104.7 KFGO.